Welcome to the second part of our presentation. In this part of the presentation, we'll discuss our achievements as well as the technical aspects of the project.
We will begin with a brief introduction to RFID before talking about our antenna design, system configuration, and graphical user interface. Then we will talk about future considerations such as improvements we will make to the project. RFID stands for Radio Frequency Identification. This technology has been around for decades and is used in everyday life, such as in public transport cards and even libraries. How does this technology work? In an RFID system, there are three main parts: the reader, the antenna, and the tag. The RFID reader provides power for the antenna, which allows it to broadcast a signal. Any tags in the proximity will absorb the energy and a small memory IC will turn on. The tag will then transmit the stored data back to the antenna and reader. This means that the antenna works both as a transmitter as well as a receiver. In this project, we are using passive RFID tags. These tags have a metallic antenna as well as the memory IC. It stores information such as the electronic product code or EPC and user data such as product name and expiry date. The RFID reader we use in this project is the Convergent Systems Limited CS468. It has an Ethernet port to connect to the PC or the network and has 16 antenna ports, meaning we can connect up to 16 antennas to the system.
When an antenna is linear polarized, its electric field travels in a single plane. These types of antenna have a longer read range since all of the energy emitted is limited to a single plane. However, this also has the disadvantage of only allowing tags to be read in a single direction. The aim of the antenna design is to be able to produce a cheaper alternative with similar or better characteristics than commercially available ones. Based on this aim, the design of the antenna had to be cheap, compact, lightweight, have high gain, and operate at a global RFID frequencies. For a compact design, a semicircular shape was used as it will decrease the patch size considerably. For the substrate, thick, low dielectric constant materials were more beneficial as this will help with the antenna bandwidth, so air was chosen as the substrate. An L-shaped slot was added to further increase the bandwidth by creating another resonant component. The initial CST simulations had a 40 MHz bandwidth, however, it did not cover the entire global RFID spectrum. A capacitor inductor feed was added to the design to introduce resonant components, which in turn increases the bandwidth. After optimization, a satisfactory S11 could not be obtained, and the antenna was simply optimized for Australian standards. In a circular polarized antenna, the electric field produced rotates in a circular motion perpendicular to the direction of propagation. This rotating field allows tags to be read in different orientations. However, it will have a much lower read range than linear polarized antenna.
For the circular polarized antenna, we began with the branch line coupler design. The branch line coupler has port 1 where the power comes in, has port 2 and port 3 which connect to the antenna, and port 4 is terminated with a 50 ohm resistor. Taking a look from the front view, the coupler is an FR4 substrate with a ground plane and a conductor on the top. The conductor can be cut away to reveal the coupler shape as seen from the top view. The main square at the center has the dimensions of a quarter wavelength. This means that the power traveling from port 1 will travel to port 2 faster than port 3, which will be a quarter wavelength or 90 degrees behind. Power should be divided equally between ports 2 and 3. The power division and 90 degrees phase shift is what gives the antenna its circular polarization. The design was first built in ADS and then simulated in CST. The following results were required. S11 had to be less than minus 10 dB at our desired frequency, meaning that very low power is reflected back to port 1. S21 and S31 are equal in magnitude at minus 3 dB, showing that the power is divided equally between ports 2 and 3. And finally, ports 2 and 3 should have a phase difference of 90 degrees.
We tried to use the same semicircular patch for the circular polarized antenna. Simulation results showed that S11 was satisfactory, however, the radiation pattern was not perpendicular to the antenna, so the design was discarded. A simpler circular antenna was used as it was symmetrical.
For both linear and circular antennas, fabrication was done here on campus at Monash University.
Both the antenna patch and the ground plane were made using 1mm thick aluminium. The coupler was made using FR4.
The antennas were tested using the vector network analyzer. Here, the S11 parameter of each antenna was obtained. The antenna gain was also tested using a horn antenna inside the anechoic chamber.
The fabricated antennas were connected with coax connectors to the RFID read. The antennas were placed on the shelf where they would best read all the items. Dummy items were made and tagged, and data such as product name and expiry date were encoded into them. This whole system was connected to the PC, which has the graphical user interface. This is a summary of the system configuration.
This is the graphical user interface that the user can use to control the RFID system. For the development of the GUI, Visual Studio and the C# language were used due to the fact that the CS468 reader had available C# API libraries. The GUI can be separated into two main components. The first main component of the GUI is the user controls. Users are able to start a single scan operation, periodic scan operation, as well as using the early expiry detection feature. In a single scan, the shelf is only scanned once. Starting the periodic scan essentially repeats a single scan periodically and allows for automation. The second main component of the GUI is the stock list. This stock list is used to display all scan information obtained from tagged medicines. Information display includes EPC, product name, expiry date, and product price. To make it easier for a user to identify the expiry state of a product, expired medicines will be highlighted orange, non-expired medicines will be highlighted green, and medicines within the early expiry detection range will be highlighted yellow. As an extra, we included a medicine counter under the stock list. The counter was used for demonstration purposes to visually see the number of products on the shelf. Here's a summary flowchart of the GUI code. When the scan operation starts, the antennas radiate energy, powering all tags on the shelf. Each tag will then transmit their EPC information back to the reader. Once all EPCs are collected, the tag interrogation starts. The reader will communicate with each individual tag and obtain its data. This is like talking to a group of people. You first ask everyone for their name, and then you can ask each person for their personal information. All information is then saved to a database and it's displayed to the stock list. If it was a single scan, then the reader will go back to the idle state. In the case of a periodic scan, then the reader waits for a period of time before collecting EPCs again.
There are many ways our project can be further improved and advanced in the future.
Firstly, the semicircular antenna should be made of brass. It was fabricated with aluminium because of availability at uni, and CST simulations show brass and aluminium gave the same results. The system can also be tested in real-life pharmacies. In our project, only single items were tested due to budget limitations.
We would ideally like to test more items to see our system capabilities. Metal shelves should also be tested, as not all stores would use wooden shelves.
To achieve integration with real-life stock updating systems, tag security must be considered, as well as database security.
Addition of extra stock list features can also be included, so that users have more control on how they analyze the data. For future projects, 3D localization of tagged products can be explored, something that was found to be very complex, and we believe this has the potential to be a project on its own.
We hope you like our video presentation, and thank you for watching.